What comes to mind? What comes to mind as I look out here is Devizes Town Hall, 1993. I arrived, put the chairs out. No bugger came and sat on them. Well, maybe three or four. I then put all the chairs back and went home poorer than when I arrived. And at that time, not only was that happening, I couldn't go in a pub or down any street in Britain without being laughed at. I'd turn on the television and a comedian would say my name and to get a laugh. And now look at it. The point is, the power that these guys I'm going to talk about in detail today use to manipulate, control, and slaughter many of us, increasingly so, is only the power we give away every single day. When we take it back, game, set, and match, it's all over. And we're in a period now, clearly, when people are waking up and that power is being taken back. I say this, that at a point when this manipulation, this global version of Nazi Germany starts to more and more put its head above the parapet where we can see it, it seems to be at its increasingly most powerful. It is in its death throes, because this is the period when people in this planet are going to take their power back from the few that have run it literally for thousands of years. Now this guy, George Orwell, wrote his book back in 1948, came out in 49, 1984, the book, in a time of universal deceit, he said, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. We are in a time of monumental deceit. At a time when, did you hear Prescott? For people in America who are seeing this on video, Prescott, the deputy prime minister, when he was trying to get Labour MPs not to go against Blair Boy this week over these weapons of mass destructions, he said, Tony doesn't lie. Tony only freaking lies. That's all he does. And what you find, and I'll go into this as we go through, this network works with reverse symbolism. Everything they say, they're actually saying the opposite. When they say they'll do something, it means they're not going to do it. When they say they won't do it, it means they are. And even the symbolism, as I'll get through in this first section, is actually a mirror of what a symbol means to us, the population, means the opposite to them. Oh, it's a big bloody stage, this, isn't it? Normally, I'm standing like this. Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. It's because we've done that for literally thousands of years that the few have taken more and more power into fewer and fewer hands. We're seeing it now all the time. We're not just getting big companies taking over small ones now, we're getting mega corporations fusing with mega corporations. We're getting decision-making politically, going further and further away from the people. And it's happening because we're allowing it to happen. But the wake-up call has arrived. I'm going to get knackered walking all around here. Shite. Now, one of the things that stops people taking this thing on is they fear the consequences. And one thing I've learned over the years, that fearing doing something is actually far worse than actually flipping doing it. And it's like, oh no, they're up there and they're powerful, I can't to talk out about them, I better keep my head down and mouth shut. Whoa. It's like a footballer. You know, you can get a footballer, gets the ball in midfield, and he looks up and there's this big hairy defense in front of him. Right? So they go, ooh, no way there. Play the ball square, get it back, make no distance forward. Ooh, can't never get through there. Then you get the little guy who's got no fear. He gets the ball, looks up, big airy defense. Whew, have some of this, darling. And he runs at them, ducking and weaving, and now who's in control? This big airy defense is now reacting to him. It's thinking about the power that is in this structure I'm talking about. That's the thing that stops most people speaking out and doing something about it. I'll give you an example. This is a Freemasonic kind of holy grail place in Boston, Massachusetts. It was one of the really early places where Freemasonry started after the movement of European peoples to the Americas. It's got about five stories and what have you. And what you'd think is, oh, never get in there. Well, we went in and went to the guy on the desk and asked if we could have a tour, right? And he said, we don't do tours. So he said, but if you want to talk to someone, go and see someone in the office. And he told us where to go. And we walked down towards this office. And this place is like the Mary Celeste. There's nobody in it. So we kept walking. And we had a camera, fortunately. And we go up the first floor and the second floor and the third floor, still nobody. And we walk into these amazing places. So here's an exclusive. The first time, probably ever, I have sat in the chair in the Freemasonic temple. I wish I'd have pulled my trouser leg up a bit. That would have been better. But it's amazing what you can do when you just go for it. Because like I say, the power that this network has over the people of the world is the power we give to them every day. The other thing that I hear people say is, mustn't talk about these things, it's negative, you'll frighten people. Well, I don't think knowledge and information is ever negative. I think ignorance is bloody negative myself. Because when we're in ignorance, we can be manipulated. Piece of cake. When we are in awareness of it, it's a very different story. So all I'm doing today is putting out information that I've gathered over the last 13 years of traveling around the world, talking to untold numbers of people in more than 40 countries, to find out what's happening behind the movie screen we're told on the news is happening every day. And what you find is that, like I said earlier, this whole edifice of power, once it's exposed, it's a house of cards, which is why it is so desperate to keep information about its existence from the people it is manipulating. And like I say, we're now in a period where the awakening is happening, and I've been almost a barometer of this from half a dozen people maybe in Devizes Town Hall to talking around the world to larger and larger audiences. And it's not me. It's the information that people are now opening their minds to, as what has remained hidden for so long is now coming to the surface. And the other thing I would say is, it's only information. I was talking to someone yesterday on the radio, and he didn't seem to be able to get it around in his head that it is possible to put out information without trying to persuade anyone it's true. It's like this idea that you must be trying to convince people. I don't care what people think. I just have a very simple, passionate belief that people should have access to all information available, and not just that which the few allow them to have. Once that's done, I'm off to the barmy. Because not only is it, I don't care what other people think, it's more than that, it's none of my bloody business what people think and make of what I say. It's theirs. It's called freedom. So I'm not trying to convince anybody of any of this stuff today. But information can be very useful. I found this in a newsagent's shop. There's this monkey that's just whacked the floor at a rate of knots. And this monkey's saying, I've told you 100 times, don't scratch your ass with both hands, you know. Information can be very, very useful. And what's kind of funny is once you know, and I've in the second section of this event today, I'll go into this in detail, and Iraq and 9/11 and all the stuff that's unfolding now, which is nothing like we're being told on CNN or whatever. Once you realize that once people start to understand the techniques that are used to manipulate them, suddenly what has been subliminal becomes crystal clear, and that's part of the awakening as well, seeing through what's actually going on. Now, I have this little system of filtering information and filtering things, and it goes like this. Take a deep breath, take a step back, look at it again. Because all the time we're getting pulled into the detail of the nonsense of the movie. And we get so pulled in, we actually think it's worth voting for this party rather than that party, when we're living in a one-party state in reality. And when you use that, take a step back, look at it again, the world can look very different. And this is an example. In America today, there's about 260, 70 million people. And I know for a fact, having traveled there extensively in recent years, that there are a lot of intelligent people in America. But do you know there's actually a lot of people in America that don't sexually abuse children? There's a lot of people in America who actually can claim rightly to have two brain cells acting in unison. You go back beyond there, there are hundreds of millions of people who have lived in what has been called the United States since it was formed. Question: why don't they ever become president of the United States? They never do. The people that want to do something for the people in general, the people that don't come with an agenda, they don't get to president. Why? Because United States presidents are not elected by ballot. This bugger wasn't, was he? Bloody hell. They are selected by blood and selected by this network. Let's just have a look at the last few. Ronald Reagan, 2 terms, as we're laughingly told, as the most powerful man in the world. This is a man who had to be given written cue cards to have conversations in White House cocktail parties. If he managed to tie his shoelaces, it was a good day. This man was 2-term president of the United States. In truth, his vice president, Father George Bush, was. And then who came next? Georgie Boy the First. From a family, when you do the research, and many have, that is one of the major hard drug running families, in certainly in North America and globally too. A notorious abuser of children, by those who've done any research on the man, President of the United States. 3 terms in truth, 2 under Reagan. And then we got this boy, didn't we? Billy Boy. <laughs> 260 million people to choose from here. Tells us something. This is Clinton in the early years. I guess he looks a little bit like me, but I swear, lady, I've never seen you before. And then, have you seen, I can't believe it, have you seen, they've got a new, they're actually opening a Clinton memorial in the mall in Washington, and I've got an exclusive design of it. There it is. It's next to the Lincoln Memorial it's going, you know. Unbelievable. President of the bloody United States. Go and bomb someone. Yeah. That position. And then here he is. Georgie boy. Who shall we bomb today, Georgie? You kids you've missed? Very bright man, very well read. Very well read, Georgie. President of the United States. By Supreme Court, which had a Bush family majority on it, stands back in amazement. He's a very good reader, Georgie. I love this one. Damnedest thing, some goofy looking guy out in the wings trying to shake hands with me. That'll be your reflection, sir. Ah, great, great, great orator is Georgie. I know how hard it is to put food on your family. It's one of his. Someone said to me once, you make these up? I couldn't make them up. Families is where our nation finds hope, where wings take dream. Redefining the role of the United States from enablers to keep the peace to enablers to keep the peace from peacekeepers is going to be an assignment. Well, he ain't bloody wrong there, is he? Georgie boy, it's your money, you paid for it. Well, I think if you say you're going to do something and don't do it, that's trustworthiness. See, I told you nothing under here. This is my favorite. This is my favorite. And there are people, I know the guy's surprised, although he didn't get enough votes to get in, there are major numbers of people in America who are still voting for Bush and believe he's some kind of man of Christianity trying to bring peace to the world. Albert Einstein said, only two things are infinite, the universe and human stupidity, and I'm not sure about the former. Because of that, this is what is happening before our eyes. And as we go through the day, I'll present the amazing similarities. No, mirror image of the techniques being used now and the techniques that were used to bring the Nazis to power and hold that power in the last century. These guys, it cannot, and as we'll see, it's not actually them. They're just the point that interacts with the public. The real people are behind the scenes that you never see, manipulating the pawns in the public eye to introduce certain policies. We are facing the rise very rapidly of the Fourth Reich, or maybe the third one coming back where we can actually see it. And it's happening in the same way it happened in Germany, with people going into denial that it's happening. I actually think, naive, stupid, not very bright, but when you go into a country just because you want to take it over and conquer it and control it so you can use it as a foothold to take over more, and you slaughter at least 7,000 civilians and you cut children to bits with cluster bombs, I think that's fascism. Myself, I think it could well be. Orwell said, if you want a picture of the future, imagine a boot stamping on the human face forever. And I have no doubt whatsoever that when he wrote 1984, because Orwell, whose real name was Eric Blair, was very much involved in the political scene in Britain, I'm sure he was writing that from a great deal of forward knowledge of what the agenda was. And this, on September the 11th, 2001, was the catalyst that has been used to justify everything that has followed. And I'll tell you, having researched it for a year after it happened, a three-year-old with two brain cells acting together could take the official story of 9/11 apart. And I'll get to that in the second section. Weapon of mass deception. That's what's happening all the time. It's not just Blair who has a genetic inability to tell the truth. It's all these people involved in the conquering of more and more countries. I wrote on my website, the day Georgie Boy was inaugurated, "Don't be at all surprised if the United States finds itself in another manipulated war during this administration. You will see monsters created in the public mind to justify such action." Exactly, it took months. And in a book called The Biggest Secret, 1998, "The plan is to engineer events, real and staged, that will create enormous fear in the countdown years to 2012. This includes a plan to start a third world war, either by stimulating the Muslim world into a holy war against the West, or by using China to cause global conflict, maybe both." And as we'll see in the second section, the documents have come to light from these people. As we'll see in the second section today, the documents that have come light, to light from within these organizations that are behind Bush and Blair, China is the place they're heading. And that's one reason why they're bringing North Korea into it. So this was allowed to happen because we, the people, have given our power away for so long that it's gone into fewer and fewer hands. And those hands have been animated by greater and greater levels of stupidity and total lack of empathy with the victims of their actions. And there's a reason for that which we'll come to later on. And it's this mentality, I mean, look at it. It's this mentality that allows it to happen. Get a brain, morons. I love it. And that really is the whole basis of how this scam can be played. A few can only control the many when the many are manipulated to control themselves. When there's a few and you want to control a mass of people, you can't do it physically. There's just too many people. But you don't have to. For me to do that, my mind has had to decide to do it. In other words, my physical behavior, my physical actions come from my mind. Therefore, all you have to do is program the people to believe your version of reality, and the people will do exactly what you say as a result of that and see the world the way you want them to see it. And if you take the analogy of a herd of sheep, it's perfect, except the human herd has taken it one step further. If you wanted to control a herd of sheep and round them up, and you wanted to do it physically, impossible. I mean, look at those two pigs that went runabout a few years ago in Britain. Took them a week to find these pigs. Because you can't do it physically. If you want to round up sheep every night, physically, you need 6 or 7 blokes for every sheep. Even then, they wouldn't be guaranteed to get it. But you don't do it that way. Two states of mind round up millions and millions of sheep all over the world every day. One, the bar mentality. Just following the one in front without question. Bah, 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 bah. And none of the sheep go, "Hey, excuse me, you at the front. Where you going?" Probably the guy probably turn around and go, "I don't know, really. I just walk every day and all these people follow me, like, you know." So the vast majority of sheep are rounded up by the bar mentality. Bar, bar. You see it in the human sense with Aopa Dave. He's a professor at university. He must know what he's talking about. He's the prime minister. He wouldn't do that. Bah, 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 bah. And then you've got the few in the sheep herd that don't want to just follow the one in front without question. They're having a good time. They want to munch over here. "No, you go. I'm staying here. This is good." And they are rounded up by the four-letter word that controls the world, fear, symbolized by the sheepdog. Row, row, row. Oh, they're in. And those two states of mind, bar, unthinkingly following the one in front, and fear, round up millions and millions of sheep every day, no problem. Now we have gone even one step further. We, the human herd, have dispensed with the sheepdog. We frighten each other into line. And once you're in that mentality, a very simple process is possible, and it's been going on for thousands of years, it's going on to this minute. All you have to do, if you're a manipulator, is to set the norms in society. What is considered good and bad, sane and insane, possible and impossible, moral and immoral, right and wrong, and you set them, you pound them out through what we laughingly call the education system. Crikey, it'd be great if we had an education system where people are educated. And you pound them out through the media, and they become the norm. But just because people don't question. So that sets a mental and emotional sheep pen of norms. The vast majority of people, whole life in there. Well, everyone knows that. This is how it's done. Everyone knows that. Well, I don't bloody know it. There's one less than everybody. And then there's the few, increasingly more, but the few compared with the people in the bar mentality who actually have sussed that this sheep pen of norms is actually incredibly limited and fundamentally flawed. What happens? They start to act differently. They start to have a different view from the norm. And what happens? They get ridiculed and condemned for the crime, which is what it's become, of being different. And any society which makes it a hassle, gives people a bad time, makes it a crime to be different, is a society based on psychological fascism, and that accounts for virtually every nation on earth. So once you get to the edge of that hassle-free zone, you've gone as far as you can within the norms, and you know if you go any further, you're going to get some serious hassle. What's going through people's mind? It's not, hey, if I do, what will Tony Blair think about me? What about George Bush? What do you think about me? Oh my God. No, no. What's making people fear expressing their uniqueness, speaking their truth, is what will my mother think? What about the neighbors? What about the people at work? What about the guys down the bar? They'll take the piss. In other words, what frightens those that wish to get out the pen to staying in is fear of what those in the pen will do and say if they get out. And that simple structure, if it was dismantled by us feeling okay, and indeed encouraging people to express their uniqueness instead of being a clone of some norm, this edifice of manipulation would crash at its foundation. Because the few can't control the many, they've got to manipulate the many to control each other. That's what I say, the power is not with these guys, it's with us, but we give it away. This is an exclusive picture of the latest clone human, just come off the... That's the kind of people they want. And you know, well, Ralph said to me, Ralph, great guy, he's done fantastic work to get this going and make this happen against a lot of odds from people who didn't want it to happen. He said to me just before, he said, you know, I've just seen the audience. It's like a profile of Britain. He said there's every culture, every color, every age group. Exactly. Because these divisions of race, of age, of background, of income bracket, they're all illusions. They're all fault lines through which to divide and rule us. And if only we stopped that, the game would be over. This is what they want. Not people with open, infinite minds, accessing the infinity of possibility, the infinity of knowledge, love, wisdom, which we all are. They want us to sit in little eggshells. No, I couldn't do that. My life's ever so boring. I never do anything. That's where they want us. Detached from infinity and in this little eggshell of program reality. And then we have the education system. I love this. This is another thing. You know, I was just thinking, if you sat down and you said, right, you want to manipulate the mind of the population. So you sat down around a table and you said, look, I don't know whether they'll stand for it, but what would be the best way of turning our young people as clones of our sense of reality we want them to have, because then they'll be controllable. And someone said, well, it's a bit far-fetched, but I'll tell you what. What we want is a system, and we'll call it education, because it's newspeak, like all we've talked about. You know, you just give a word for the opposite of what it is. And we'll call it education, and it means that we'll take children from their parents at a very early age, and we'll keep them there about 5 days a week at least, all the way through their formative years, and we'll pound them every day with our version of reality. They'd never stand for that. That's what we have. Now, there's two sides of the brain. There's the left brain, which is like this world thinks in words. It thinks in logic. Physical worldview, can I see it, touch it, taste it, smell it? Ah, it exists then. And then there's the right brain, which is inspiration, creativity, the artist, the person who does not see limits. Someone who thinks through the heart as well as the brain, the mind. And what the education system wants to do is pour information, most of it provable crap, into the left brain, and it says, hold it there, darlings, until we give you a shout. And then it says, ladies and gentlemen, you have 2 hours to complete this paper. Please pick up your pens. At which point you're supposed to spew out what it has told you onto the paper. And if you do that well, you get rewarded. Hey, my John is very clever. Hey, you get a good job with all those passes. Oh, your John is well indoctrinated, isn't he? Yes. Now, carrot and stick, if you are thinking for yourself and you're a young guy or a young girl and you take that stuff in there and you whip it over there and give it a look, and you go, it's a piece of shit, look at it, look at it. If you tell your exam paper that, there's a phone call. Hello, is that Mrs. Jones? Billy's a disruptive influence in the classroom. You mean he's asking questions? Yes, they'll all want to do it. Yeah? You know, in the last part of the talk, I'm really going to get into the nature of reality and how we create it, because there's so much information and supporting evidence now to give us a real fix on how we're creating reality, because this is an illusion. But how is it an illusion? How do we create it? More and more knowledge on that. But these guys, these manipulators, know it's an illusion, and they know we're creating it through our minds, and so they know if they program our minds with the right illusion, we'll create it physically. And the education system is massively, massively part of that. As H.L. Mencken, an American writer, said all those years ago, the most dangerous man to any government is the man who is able to think things out for himself. Almost inevitably, he comes to the conclusion that the government he lives under is dishonest, insane, and intolerable. And that is why we are pressured from cradle to grave not to figure it out. Sorry, boys, no can do. So shut up, keep your head down, keep your mouth shut, go with the flow, and life's easier that way. Or, as the Japanese have a national saying, don't be the nail that stands out above the rest, because that's the first one to get hit. That is the mentality. That allows the few to control the many, and without it, they couldn't do it. And on the other side, bad monkey, no banana. Ooh, don't play our game. Smacky. You will not progress within our system. Come into line or you're an outcast. Or a rebel. Oh, a rebel. So, this is going to come up a few times as we go along. Because this is what's happening every day. And it will become more and more obvious as we go through the day. You have a secret agenda for literally the centralized fascist control of the world, with a world government that would dictate to all nations, a world army that would impose the will of the world government on those nations that did not wish to go with what it was told to do, a world central bank that would dictate the financial system of the world, a world currency, which the European currency is a stepping stone to, which is why they're having no truck with people making a decision. They will not go with a referendum until they know they're going to win it. And a microchip population linked to a global computer. Thousands of people are being microchipped in America now as a result of 9/11. And I'll get into that in the second section of this talk. Now, to introduce this agenda, they need, in the movie, that which we see on the television news every day, they have to find excuses to bring in different elements of the agenda by creating mythical excuses for it in the movie. This is why, when they want to invade Iraq, secret agenda, want to get in there, I'll go into this in detail later on, they want to go into Iraq because it's part of the process of taking over the Middle East, they need to create an excuse for that in the movie, thus hiding that and justifying the elements of it being introduced. So they come up with weapons of mass destruction. Weapons of mass destruction, weapons of mass destruction, weapons of mass destruction, the mantra. Once you hear them with a mantra, you know something's coming. So that's how they're doing it, and I'll get into that in detail later. And also, towards the end, I'll get into this part of it, which is the fact that this world, like I say, is an illusion. It's a matrix of manipulated, indoctrinated belief in a reality that suits the agenda. And all it is an illusion. We think, when we look over there, that the walls of this theater are solid. They cannot be. It is impossible, because they're made of atoms which are anything about as least solid as you can get. We make it solid by our minds. And this is the information. This is the information that's being kept from us so they can manipulate our reality without us realizing that we're creating the reality they're manipulating us to have. Now, and I'm an illusion as well. Now, I saw this in a newsagent's shop as well. These two lady peacocks are saying to the male peacock, cut the crap and show us your willy. And so, I don't want to clear the theater, so I won't take it literally, but that's what we're going to do now. Look behind the movie screen and see what's going on that we're not told about and we don't see. This is the structure that's been used by the few to control the many for literally thousands of years. It's the compartmentalized pyramid. What you do is, if you look at any organization today, it's structured as a pyramid. You've got the few at the top of the organization that know what the real deal is, what the real agenda is. And the further you come down, you're meeting more and more people in the organization who know less and less and less about what the organization's really about. Your CIA and people like that call it compartmentalization. And so what this network does that goes under the name, calls itself the Illuminati, the illuminated ones, illuminated into knowledge the rest of the population doesn't get, is it hoards knowledge at the top level of these pyramids and keeps the people in ignorance of it. And up there is fantastic knowledge all the way through history that has been kept from the people. And therefore, what the people think is possible here, they know is nothing like the limits of possibility. And a few years ago, I got some idea of the kind of knowledge and technology that exists up there that's kept from the people, when I was asked through a third party to meet a CIA scientist who was desperate to get information out about what was actually going on. He joined the CIA as a young guy in his 20s because he was a genius in the area of magnetics and they wanted to use that genius. He thought he was serving his country down the bottom here of the pyramid. And he said, when he started working for them, he started to realize that this deal that I'm talking about today actually was really a reality and no theory. And he realized that what they wanted his genius for was to create technology to advance this agenda. And he rebelled against it. And when he rebelled against it, he was telling me he left home one day when he was refusing to work for them, and he has missing time from the moment he left home to when he woke up in this room on a medical-type bench. And he said when he got his faculties back, and he was opening his shirt, he was telling me this, and on his chest was like a see-through shampoo sachet. What they call them in the CIA is patches. Someone's been patched. And I could see in this patch a orangey golden liquid. And what had happened, he said, was that his body had been manipulated to need this drug to survive, and these patches have to be replaced every 72 hours, and if they're not replaced, he starts to die. And he has a family. I was there with his family when I met him. He doesn't want to die, so he starts working for the CIA again. And what he said to me was that there is technology that's been around for decades to cure cancer. Technology, drugs, what have you, to cure cancer. He said there's technology to create abundant growth in deserts without water. Why is this stuff not introduced when people are dying through hunger? It's not introduced because of a simple equation. Abundance equals choice equals freedom. Scarcity equals dependency equals control. And so what we have... is manufactured dependency all over the developing world, because that equals control. Here's a guy from the United Nations food program. Food is power. We use it to change behavior. Some may call that bribery. We do not apologize. I've traveled Africa a lot, spent a lot of time in South Africa, particularly in recent years. The idea that that continent can't feed itself if left to its own devices is ludicrous. It can't, because transnational corporations take over vast amounts of food-growing land to provide cash crops for the Western market, and there are manipulated wars all over Africa that make abundant food-growing land no-go areas. No need for this. It's manufactured. And so you have this structure of hoarding knowledge and keeping it from the people. And I started to think about when this structure was first started, because by the time I wrote a book called And the Truth Shall Set You Free, back in the mid-90s, I'd started to piece together, which I'll get into later on, how the world is manipulated today. It's a very simple structure. It has to be, or it's going to get too complex to work. And so I started to go back looking for some kind of origin for this manipulation. You get back very quickly to the point where you realize that the institutions of power today have not been infiltrated by this network. They were created and structured as they are by the network in the first place to give the illusion of freedom and choice while fundamentally limiting both. And you continue to go back. I got comfortably back to around the time of the Crusades in the so-called Holy Land, around the 1200s time, when a lot of secret societies were created that actually are still going strong today and have among their number the top people in global politics, business, banking, media ownership. And I kept going back, and eventually you're thousands of years BC before you're picking up some kind of theme. It's not the start of it, but it's a point where you can start to pick it up. And it's in this area of the world, what is now Turkey, up to the Caucasus Mountains, and what is now Iraq particularly. Iraq was the home of the very advanced culture, going back to 4000 BC, down to around 2000 BC, of Sumer. In the same area that we call Iraq today is Babylon. And interestingly, it was the texts and accounts and records of that very area, of those cultures, that were destroyed and many priceless artifacts from that time looted, according to the museum directors, by experts who knew what they were looking for when all the chaos broke as a result of the invasion of Iraq. And in this area, certain family lines that were considered to be royal lines and claimed to have the right to rule the people because of their bloodline, what we call the royal families, started to appear. And as you move through history, these families exported themselves out into Europe, where they became the aristocracy of Europe and the royal families of Europe, royal family of Europe in truth, and then through what we call the great British Empire and other European empires, but particularly the British and particularly the French together, these royal bloodlines were exported all over the world, to North America, to Australia, and elsewhere. And they are the ones today that turn up in the positions of ruling power in politics and banking and what have you. Babylon was a ancient headquarters of this Illuminati. Like I said, and that's why, as we'll get to as we go through, these Illuminati today use a tremendous amount of Babylonian symbolism in their own codes and language. This is the area I'm talking about. Egypt came into it as well, but this area was crucial to that this point where we pick the story up. And this, of course, is the very area that these guys are now going back in with a list of countries to take over in the same area of the world. So you had these royal bloodlines that moved up into the into Europe and became the aristocracy and royal families of Europe, etc. And a lot of researchers are now starting to look at this, because it was very clear to me when I started to investigate this that for some reason these Illuminati families are obsessed with interbreeding with each other. And this has been put together from a number of different genealogical sources: Burke's Peerage, the Boston Historical Genealogical Society that looks at the genealogy of presidents of the United States. And you find that you can pick up certain lines in that ancient part of the world that I'm talking about and come down right the way through to the present day. Philip of Macedonia, who was the father of Alexander the Great, that before he died in Babylon around the age of 32, 33, had taken over much of that blue and white map we saw a few seconds ago. Comes down through the royal lines of Egypt and the Roman Empire, down through Herod, the king mentioned in the Bible stories, also comes down through Constantine the Great, who was the Roman emperor who in 325 AD called the Council of Nicaea that created the structure that still is Christianity to this day. And it comes down through the Merovingians. Now, the Merovingians kind of disappeared from history and then came to light more recently in the last, I don't know, 20 years or so, through books like Holy Blood, Holy Grail, that investigated what was claimed to be the bloodline of Jesus. I think there's another interpretation of that myself, that included the Merovingians in what we now call France. The Merovingians were a royal line of a group of people called the Sicambrian Franks, who became known as the Franks, and that's where France comes from. And the Merovingians are a royal bloodline that were big goddess Diana worshippers. And they were very much based in what we now call France and Paris. And the royal families of Europe are all connected into the Merovingian bloodline. Also, the vast overwhelming majority of American presidents, from George Washington to George W. Bush, connect into that same bloodline. In fact, another one on this list, Charlemagne, one of the most famous monarchs of what we now call France, that went on from the Merovingians, of the 43 presidents of the United States, from Washington to Bush, 34 go back to Charlemagne. The Habsburgs, that were the family that ruled the Holy Roman Empire in Europe for centuries, connect into this same bloodline. And the de' Medici family, big bloodline in Italy, banking family, and the House of Lorraine in France, up to this day an important bloodline in the Illuminati. And interestingly, a couple of very famous people were connected to both the de' Medici family and the House of Lorraine. One was called Christopher Columbus, who was connected to both. Christopher Columbus was not looking for India and tripped over the Americas. He knew pretty much where he was going because of the knowledge held outside the public arena. And another guy who worked for both families, we know as Nostradamus, Michel de Notre Dame. The reason that guy, I'm not saying he was a bad guy or anything, but the reason he had tremendous esoteric knowledge compared with the rest of the population is because he had access into these advanced levels of knowledge that are passed over through this secret society network through history and kept from the people. This is Charlemagne here, outside the Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. So it comes down all the way through these lines and all the way down through the French royal lines and into the British royal families as well, right down to the present one that connects into the Merovingians also. And because of this process of taking the bloodlines out with the British Empire, it goes into the presidents of the United States as well. As Burke's Peerage said one election ago in America, every single presidential election, bar none, from Washington to George W. Bush, has been won by the candidate with the most royal genes. And therefore, they've started to predict presidencies, because they picked this up some elections ago. They've started to select presidents or predict presidents on the basis of their royal heritage. Right down to these two who lock into this same network. And this is why it was possible to predict that George W. Bush would be the next president of the United States 3 years before he came president. Two reasons. First of all, the bloodline, the connection into the Bush family, which is a very significant Illuminati family in America, and also the fact that they were bringing him to political prominence in Texas as governor. So this guy was not, well, he wasn't elected, but he was selected long before. Now, this is an alternative genealogy, which I do have sympathy with, I have to say. Comes down through Scottish family bloodlines as well. Very, very important area for the Illuminati, Scotland, in history. And that's one of the reasons the biggest secret society in the world is called the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry, after that very small country at the top of the British Isles. Joseph Smith, who started the Mormon Church, which is an Illuminati front, big time in Salt Lake City, Merovingian bloodline. The guy who took it on, Brigham Young, Merovingian bloodline. The guy, just one quick mention before I go to the next guy. This is the state seal of Utah, a symbol of the Merovingian bloodline going right back in history, is the beehive or the bee. And so you have that right at the heart of the Utah state seal. And Utah, of course, is a wholly owned subsidiary of the Mormon Church. Interestingly, another symbol of the Merovingian bloodline going back into history is the fleur-de-lis that you see all over British royalty. Charles Taze Russell, who created the Jehovah's Witness movement, along with others, Merovingian bloodline, buried under a pyramid in America. And these religions like that are created again to divide and rule and program people into certain beliefs and to keep them in the pen, in the web. And I'm far from the only person that started to realize that there is an Illuminati bloodline that they are obsessed with maintaining. So as this has passed through history, this network has been behind many different empires. Starting with the Babylonian, when you can pick it up, and then eventually it moved to Rome. And when it was in Rome, that's when we had the creation of the Roman Empire and the creation of the Roman Church that became Christianity as we know it. They then eventually moved up further into Europe. And one of the major operational centers to this day is London, and particularly that part of London known as the City of London, where the financial district is. And the number of secret societies, elite ones, within this web in the City of London is enormous compared with most other parts of the world. America's important, very much so, but to a very large extent, America is used to fire the bullets that are actually loaded in Europe. Because if you want to hide where the power is. You want people looking over there when the power is over there. So to a very large extent, America has been set up to fire the bullets and take the focus of people when the real power is behind here in Europe, in places like Paris and Germany. So what you've got eventually, as the British Empire and these other empires exported the Illuminati, not just its bloodline, but the secret society network through which it manipulates, you create a situation where it's like a spider's web. The center is in Europe. That's where the real deal is manipulated from. Then in the different areas of the world, different countries, you have what I call the bloodline branch managers, that their job is to control their country's political system, banking system, business system, and media ownership. And so from the center of the web, the policy for the centralization of power is dictated, and the job then is for the people in the different countries to introduce that agenda in their particular sphere of influence. Which is why you find, when you travel around, that the same things are introduced in different countries, apparently unconnected, at the same time. Even some wording of the legislation is exactly the same. It's because it's coordinated from a central point, because of the system I'm talking about, the spider's web. And so what they've created as they've passed through history is this structure of pyramids within pyramids. It's like Russian dolls, one doll inside a bigger doll inside a bigger doll. This is small pyramids inside bigger pyramids inside bigger pyramids. So if you work in a local bank, taking the checks across the counter, you don't know what's being decided in the bank manager's office behind you, never mind what's being happening at higher levels of the bank. The bank manager behind you doesn't know what's happening at the next level, and they don't know what's happening at the next level. And so even in a single bank, there's a tiny few at the top that know what's going on, and the rest of them only know what they need to know to make their contribution. The only people that know how all those contributions fit together are the few at the top. And then that bank goes into another pyramid and another pyramid until eventually you've got one that encompasses the whole of the global banking system. And when you get to the top, you find the same few family lines. And they're dictating down the system a policy to unfold this agenda of centralization. A transnational corporation in itself is a compartmentalized pyramid, massively so. But if you go to a high enough pyramid in that network, you find one that encompasses all the transnational corporations. And at the top of that are the same people that are at the top of the banking system. A few years ago, maybe a couple of years ago, maybe not that quite that long, a journalist worth the name called John Pilger did a very good documentary on ITV about globalization. What is globalization, for goodness sake? It's the agenda unfolding, the centralization of global power. It's not just big, bad, greedy corporations. They are the vehicle to achieve global centralization of power. And what Pilger said in this documentary, that today, a quarter of the world's economic activity is down to around 200 companies. Staggering enough. But if you go to the next level, the pyramid that encompasses all of them, they are the same company, in effect. And so what you can have is, from this point, with all these different pyramids going into the same pyramid peak, you can have the same policy of incessant centralization of power coming down these apparently, at our level of experience, unconnected organizations and institutions. And the more you centralize power, the more power you have to centralize it even quicker. And that's why this momentum for constant centralization has got faster and faster and faster and faster and faster. And will continue to do so as this process continues of centralize more power, centralize quicker. So, you can have situations, and you do all over the place, where in the movie level, situations are set up, conflicts, us against them, this religion against that religion, war. But actually, the two sides are ultimately manipulated by the same force. And we believe the movie when it's just a scam to bring in the agenda. And just a quick one on that. If you want to control a game, and these guys are obsessed with controlling the outcome before the movie starts. And if you want to control a football match, and you control one side, you're going to influence the football match. But you don't know what the result's going to be before a ball's kicked, because there's another side you don't control. So in all debates, whether it's more power in the centralization of Europe, or whether it's GM foods or whatever, they try to control both sides of the debate, give the illusion in the movie of some kind of free choice and debate, while knowing the outcome before it starts. What have they decided about GM food? They're going to introduce it. What have they decided about putting fluoride in British water? They're going to introduce it. What have they decided about going more and more into the European superstate? They're going to do it. Those decisions have long been made. All the rest is just giving us the illusion of we're having some kind of say. Now, this is the greatest form of imprisonment. It's what I call the prison without the bars. What happened was, eventually, the colonial powers of Europe, like the British Empire, they reached the point with their colonies around the world where they could no longer hold on to that power overtly, because the people were starting to kick up a stink. So they, in the movie, gave those countries independence from the colonial power in Europe. What actually happened is they swapped one form of dictatorship for another. And then the other is the most potent form of dictatorship at all. The one they, there's two forms of dictatorship. There's one that you can see, touch, taste, and experience. Fascism, communism, whatever. Centralization of power with a dictator, and you know he's a dictator. It may take some time, but eventually the desire for freedom in the human heart will rebel against that kind of dictatorship, because you can see it. You can focus on it. The greatest form of dictatorship is the hidden hand, which gives you the illusion of freedom while fundamentally controlling your lives, because people do not rebel against not being free when they believe they are. So like I say, what happened was, when the colonial powers apparently pulled out of North America, pulled out of Africa, pulled out of Asia, and Australia, and all these other countries, they left behind their secret society network and the bloodlines that they're so obsessed with, and they have gone on controlling those countries ever since, while the people of those countries have believed they were free. The prison without the bars. And this spider's web I'm talking about allows that process to happen. And the spider, that which is really calling the shots, really orchestrating the centralization of global power, the fascist state, is not among those that we see. If you can see them, they're still gophers. Maybe powerful gophers on the level they operate, like Bush or Blair or whatever, but they're still gophers. The people really behind this, you never see, because why are they going to put themselves on public display where they can be identified and targeted? There's a wonderful example I give you. I spent a lot of time in South Africa in recent years. I've become a great friend of a man called Credo Mutwa, who is the official historian of the Zulu Nation. Wonderful man. And he's filled me in on so many things that went on there during the apartheid regime. But this is a classic example. During apartheid, you had an in-your-face dictatorship. You knew where you stood. You were in a situation of control by the few. As a result of that, there was rebellion within South Africa, quite right, because they knew where they were. All across the world, there were all these protests. There were sanctions, there were all these things because the people around the world could see it. Apartheid, control. At that time, a few families in South Africa owned the gold mines, they owned the diamond mines, and they controlled at least, and is at least, 80% of the South African stock market. Then we had this movement to give a vote to black people in South Africa. Quite right. Mandela was brought into the presidency. We now have Thabo Mbeki. Today, in South Africa, there have been changes on the surface. Yes. But who actually controls the lives of the people in South Africa? Today, all these years later, those same families that controlled the gold mines and the diamond mines and the stock market and the media before apartheid continue to do so. But what has happened since? What has happened now? No rebellion. Where's all the protests of the placards around the world? Human rights in South Africa, that people are not free. All gone. Because of the movement from in-your-face dictatorship to hidden hand control. And that has happened all over the world. Now, one of the things that I found as I went through this, and in this first section, I'm just going to look at some of the different elements of it, a little bit of history, and then after we've had a break, I'm going to big time go into what's happening today. Stunning stuff, that is. Crikey, you couldn't make that up. The thing that I started to realize is that these people were not just obsessed with bloodline. And what obsessed with bloodline? Crikey, it's just a body to experience this reality. But it's important to them for some reason, which we'll get to. But they're also obsessed with symbolism. Utterly obsessed with it. And there's a reason for that, which I'll get to later as well. And like I said, a lot of their symbolism comes from ancient Babylon and that kind of area, even going further back. And a part of that is an obsession with the goddess. The Illuminati goddess keeps coming up all the time as well. So the way they structure themselves are like a secret society. You have all these different degrees within a secret society. And like in the Freemasons, the vast majority of Freemasons don't get any higher than the bottom three levels of degree, the so-called blue degrees. So when people say, it's the Freemasons, well, hold on a minute. There's a lot of Freemasons, and the overwhelming vast majority of them have no comprehension of what their organization's being used for. It's not the anyone. It's this network that works through all these different organizations and controls them covertly. Only a few within the Freemasons actually know what the real deal is. Most of them just, good for a bit of business in the local community, wheel the wife out for the dinner once a year, and they have these silly rituals. I don't understand what they are, but it gets you in. That's the level we're talking about. But within that organization are people that do know the deal and are using that Freemasonic network to advance it. And some of these secret societies, which use this goddess symbolism, which I'll get to in a second, and these other symbolic things that are all around us, go back a very, very long time. The Freemasons did not begin in the, 1600s, 1700s like they claim. That was just when they moved and called themselves another name. This thing goes back to the far ancient world. And just to give you an idea of that, I just want to pick three secret societies up that were formed around the time of the Crusades. In the 1100s they were formed and through into the 1200s. And they were formed in that area of the world, Jerusalem, that kind of area, during the Crusades in that period, like I say. One of them was called the Teutonic Knights, that relate to Germany. And that Teutonic Knight network continues today, and it was that network in Germany in the 20th century that created the Nazi Party and brought it to power. Another one formed around the same time in the same area of the world was called the Knights Hospitaller of St. John of Jerusalem, which in its Catholic version today is known as the Knights of Malta. The official head is the Pope, and in its Protestant version is known as the Knights of St. John of Jerusalem, and the official head is the Monarch of England. The one I just want to follow just for a few minutes to give you just an idea of how the secret societies in the ancient world have come through to the present day, is to talk about one that was formed again at the same time as the other two, basically, called the Knights Templar. This was an organization came out of France and came to Jerusalem, and there were only about nine of them. And they parked themselves next to Temple Mount, and their official story is that they were formed to protect pilgrims visiting the Holy Land. Well, you're going to protect a lot of pilgrims with nine people. It's a cover story. They stayed there for some 9 years or so, and according to excavations in that area in the 19th century, artifacts and things were found, signs were found that the Templars had been under Temple Mount. Whatever, something changed very quickly after around 9 years, because a couple of these guys came back to France and started signing up the aristocratic families of Europe. They clearly knew something big time. They became extremely wealthy because you had to give your wealth and land to the Templars to join. And they set up what is effectively the banking system of Europe out of places like Paris and London that were their major headquarters. In 1307, they had the crown heads of Europe up to their necks in debt to them with a scam that follows these bloodlines everywhere that they have come, right to the present day. And the scam is lending people money that doesn't exist and charging them interest on it. That's the scam. A lot of people don't realize that when you go to a bank and you want to borrow 50 grand, the bank doesn't pull 50 grand out the bloody vault. It doesn't move a piece of precious metal a single sodding inch. All it does is type into your account 50 grand, and from that moment on, you start paying interest on money that has not, does not, and will never exist. Huh? I've got a great idea, no one wants to hear it. To solve world debt, the debt of business, the debt of individuals, all of it. Jam jars. Jam jars. I thought it'd go down well. What we do is we have a national campaign of collecting jam jars, empty ones. We put the lid on, so trapping the air, and we deliver them to the bank saying, just paying back what we borrowed, and that's the frickin' end of it. And ludicrous as that may sound, that's actually what we're borrowing. Now, because the same network, the Illuminati, has controlled the politicians, it also controls the banks, they've got the politicians to make legislation that gives the banks the right to lend at least 10 times what it has on deposit, therefore giving it the ability to lend fresh air and charge money for it. This is how it works once you see the structure that we're being controlled within. So anyway, the Knights Templar were eventually purged by Philip the Fair, the King of France, in 1307. On Friday the 13th, which is why Friday the 13th has been considered unlucky ever since, apparently, and they went runabout. They almost certainly went to the Americas, because the knowledge of the Americas existed goes back a long way in the secret knowledge line. They also went to Scotland, which I'll get to in a second, but they went down significantly to the United States, to Portugal, where they hid behind a front called the Knights of Christ that was the Templars under another name. And this is very significant because one of the most famous Grand Masters of the Knights of Christ was a guy called Prince Henry the Navigator, and one of his sea captains was very close to him, was the father-in-law of Christopher Columbus. And it's within the Templars, and within particularly those that were exploring on behalf of the Templars, they had maps going back to the ancient world, some of which have come to light, that showed that the Americas existed long before official history says anyone knew it did. Though I think the Native Americans probably knew it existed. I think they probably sussed it. So when Columbus went on his trip, he wasn't looking for India. He pretty much knew where he was going because of that. This was the Knights Templar. The red cross on the white background was its symbol, which of course is the flag of England, and St. George comes from that same area of the world, what we call Cappadocia, now Turkey. And the great work, which is one of the names they give to this movement through the ages of taking the planet over, was massively advanced when Columbus made his trip, also another guy I'll come to in a second made the trip to find North America, and the whole movement of peoples from Europe could go and take the North American continent over. This is Christopher Columbus. He went and found that bit. And this is John Cabot, whose real name was Giovanni Caboto, a naturalized Venetian, and he left the Templar port of Bristol to find North America about 4 or 5 years after he found that bit. Official history doesn't put them together, but you can. A Freemasonic historian who got to the 32nd degree, I think, of the Scottish Rite, called Manly P. Hall in America, wrote a book about this, and he says that Columbus and Cabot, Giovanni Caboto, were both connected into the same secret society networks in Genoa, and therefore they both were working to the same plan when they found North America, because then the whole business of moving in on that continent could start. This is Chris. A number of people have kind of made the point that they call him Christopher Columbus, but he used to sign his name colon. That was, I said that in America once, you know. I said, why do you call Powell colon Powell? And someone said, because he's full of shit. I thought was quite good myself. But why do they? You know what I mean? Everything is symbolism. So was Columbus. Columbus. When you go back to Babylon, you find that they worshipped a trinity of Nimrod, the father, who they symbolize as a fish, Ninus Tamus, the son, and they said father and son were one. I've heard that somewhere before. This is thousands of years BC. And the female point of the Babylonian trinity was someone called Queen Semiramis. Queen Semiramis has become a symbol of the Illuminati, in the Illuminati goddess I was talking about earlier. And when they moved their headquarters from Babylon to Rome, the Romans used to worship Queen Semiramis under the term Venus Columba, Venus the dove, because the Babylonians used to symbolize Semiramis as a dove. Still today, in French, the word for dove is Columba. So Columbus was a play on Columba, the goddess of the Illuminati Queen Semiramis. Now look at that. This is a Queen Semiramis as portrayed on an ancient coin. I've seen her somewhere before. The Statue of Liberty, I was talking earlier about reverse symbolism. The Statue of Liberty, in the mind of the American people, understandably stands for liberty. What it actually stands for is we're running the show, we're showing you, but you can't see it, can you? That statue was given to New York by French Freemasons in Paris who knew what it really represented. I'll get more into that as we go along. As a result, the goddess of the French Republic is symbolized in the same way, because as the bloodlines came through, all these different symbols of the Illuminati were implanted. The goddess Columbia, District of Columbia, again, the same, Semiramis. And so we have the very center of government in America, in the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., British Columbia, Columbia Broadcasting, Columbia University, CBS, Columbia Broadcasting, Illuminati-owned television network in America, along with the others. And so you get the dove, Semiramis symbolism, on the Supreme Council of Freemasons in Britain. Again, the dove you find very prevalent in those sticks that she holds when she's doing her ceremonies, septics or something. Is it me? They say I'm bloody mad. I'm happy to accept that. But backing out of a room because of some woman who's just got a certain DNA. I mean, excuse me, it's 2000 and bloody three. And those crosses are the cross of the Knights of Malta, the Maltese cross. And you find the goddess all over the place in the symbolism of the Illuminati. This I took, or a picture was taken, in one of those temples in that Boston Freemasonic headquarters I talked about earlier. There's Benjamin Franklin, another one of the gang he was. And you see the same symbolism going through history. This is Isis, as symbolized by the Egyptians holding Horus, the son of God of Egypt, and this is Mary holding Jesus, the son of God of Christianity, and the same things come up. They just give them different names. The other thing they do is they reverse symbolism, everything, like I said. So one of the things the Templars and the people that set up the Templars and others used to worship was the Black Madonna. Now, this is nothing to do with color or race. It's to do with this reverse symbolism. If something is accepted by the population as white, portrayed as white, the Illuminati symbolism is it's black. When it's portrayed as black, the Illuminati symbolism is it's white. Everything is turned around. And this is why the classic symbol of Satanism is the five-pointed star reversed, so it's pointing down. The Nazis turned the swastika around to indicate the negative for the same reason. Swastika is a very ancient symbol. And for the same reason, this worship of the goddess, you've got the mother lodge of Freemasonry in London, and where did they place it? Great Queen Street. Great Queen was one of the names they gave to Queen Semiramis, also the Virgin Queen. And I love it when the official history tells us that they named Virginia after the Virgin Queen, Queen Elizabeth I. I love it. She was no more a virgin than Madonna, that woman, was she? I mean, that sounds a bloody laugh. Virgin Queen, however, is Semiramis symbolism, part of the whole deal. Something else that happened in that 1307 purge in France and further afield was that the Templars, because they had a massive fleet of ships by this time doing all their trade, they were just an absolute massive transnational corporation. They went round the west coast of Ireland, this is well documented in a number of books now, and they hid in Scotland, another group of them, and they eventually re-emerged under another name, the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry, the biggest secret society in terms of numbers in the world today, like I say, going through all business and banking, all the other stuff. And this, to a very large extent, at a place called Rosslyn, which is actually just down the road, literally about 3 minutes in a car, from the Rosslyn Institute, where they clone that sheep, Dolly. This is the church chapel, Rosslyn Chapel, that was built by the Sinclair family, as it was by then, but was actually originally in France, the St. Clair family, and the St. Clair family were massively involved in the creation of the Templars. Eventually they moved to Scotland, became the Sinclairs, and they built this chapel, which is a very much a holy grail for the Illuminati in many ways. And in the stonework, you find depictions of aloe plants and other plants and cactus plants that were found at that time anyway, only in the United States as it became. And that's significant because this chapel was built and the stonework put in many, many years before Columbus got in his ship, and official history says he discovered the Americas. These guys were there a long time before. So after this, you had this big influx of people and the occupation of North America began, and the Native Americans were pushed back and put on reservations and what have you, and we had the nation built that has become, on the face of it, the most powerful nation on earth. And Francis Bacon wrote a book called The New Atlantis. Francis Bacon was an initiate of this network, wrote a book called The New Atlantis, which was looking forward to the new America. So then you had this colony in America, and then you had the time when the colonies apparently rebelled and wanted independence. A lot of the founding fathers, I'm not saying all of them, but a lot of the founding fathers, like Benjamin Franklin here, were Illuminati placemen. Their role was to move America from an in-your-face colonial dictatorship to a covert, controlled from Europe still, underground hidden hand dictatorship. While this guy was opposing royal rule from Britain, he was a bosom pal of the royal family of Britain. He was in a notorious secret society called the Hellfire Club, in which the royal family had members, and was run by a guy called Sir Francis Dashwood on his estate at Wickham, that was involved in horrendous bloody rituals and what have you, which again follow these bloodlines all the way through history. He was just there to ease the nature of the dictatorship from one to another. And interestingly, a few years ago, they had a £1.5 million grant to to renovate his former house in Craven Street near Trafalgar Square into a museum to his life. And when they dug the floor up, this is what this is about, they found 10 bodies, six of them children, under his floor. And this story is talking about how the bodies have been connected to the time that he was there, and it says that he must have been into body snatching for medical research. When you realize what the Hellfire Club were up to, I think there could be an alternative explanation. And then you had the process of the new government of the United States, George Washington, aristocratic British bloodline, and so they went on all the way through to the present day. This guy was a high degree Freemason, George Washington, one of the top ones, and he became the first president, no coincidence. Here's his apron. He must do a lot of washing up or something, I don't know. Bloody, I can't believe it. I'm just putting me apron on, darling. He was also, apparently, I was reading, a member of the Knight of the Garter. This is the guy who opposed British control of America, but and was in this grouping around the Queen. Also, right the way through to the present day, the presidents are not only connected to the bloodline, they're fundamentally involved in the secret society network that puts the bloodlines into power. This is a picture taken in that Boston Freemasonic Lodge where we were walking around it. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, honorary Grand Master of the Order of de Molay. This comes from a guy called Jacques de Molay, who was the Grand Master of the Knights Templar in France at the time of the purge in 1307. Bill Clinton was also a member of the Order de Molay. Right down to these people, fundamentally involved in the secret society network and the satanic networks. And when he was inaugurated in 2001, he actually swore the oath on the same Freemasonic Bible from the New York Lodge that George Washington had done back in 1789. So, they have a secret language, and when I get towards the end, there's a major reason why they have a secret language, because the way we're manipulated overwhelmingly is through the subconscious mind, what people call subliminals. And the language of the subconscious is symbolism to a very large extent, and you can manipulate the subconscious mind with symbolism, which I'll get to later. So you have this structure going through history, keeping this knowledge to the few and keeping the people in ignorance of it. And this is a book by a guy called James Churchwood, who was a man who investigated the alleged existence of an ancient civilization called Mu or Lemuria in the Pacific, which is supposed to have gone down in great cataclysms and what have you. And he traveled to isolated monasteries in Asia, where he said he was shown tablets and accounts going back literally tens of thousands of years. And among the things he was shown, this is from his book, were a number of ancient symbols going way, way back into prehistory. And these are the symbols to this day of the Illuminati. That, of course, was what the Nazis picked up. And the Nazis were an occult, in the negative sense of the word, because there's a positive too, secret society. There you have the Knights of Malta cross. These are not just picked out of the air. Oh, that looks a nice cross. We'll have that one. They mean something going way back, and I'll come to what that one is all about in a second as well. One of the great symbols of the Illuminati, which you see all the time, is the sun, because it represents illumination, illuminated into the knowledge the rest of the population don't get. And also, it's an understanding that the sun has a tremendous effect on life on Earth. 99% of the mass of the solar system is represented in the sun, and it sends out fantastic projections of energy which come to the Earth on what's called the solar wind, and they affect electrical systems and what have you here at their most powerful, and they certainly affect us and the way we react to events. And they follow these cycles all the time, these cycles of moon cycles and sun cycles, because they're having an effect on us, and sometimes they can play a card most effectively and sometimes less effectively. They're reading them all the time. While they're laughing at things like astrology and dismissing it, they're using it in a very, very detailed manner all the time. I know a number of astrologers around the world who are on retainers from the CEOs of transnational corporations who consult the astrologer on when to launch a new product, when to have a takeover bid and what have you, because they know that the energy matters. And so you find, coming all the way through history, you see this symbolism of the sun again and again. This is in Egypt. This is in Sri Lanka. This is Rome, again, the sun. And the sun became symbolized in the lion, the mane of the lion representing the rays of the sun. And so the lion became the king of the jungle, the king of the solar system. And that's one of the reasons you find a British royalty symbolism awash with lions and what have you. Coming closer to the present day, this was the sun chair of George Washington, that high degree Freemason. And again, the symbolism is of the sun, and it particularly represents Horus, the sun of god of Egypt, and that comes up again and again in symbolism, as and we'll see as we go along. Again, the sun coming up over the horizon is in a number of state seals in America. Illinois is not famous for its sun, but that represents something in the Illuminati symbolism. Again, the sun is represented in that Boston Freemasonic Lodge. Over Downing Street, that is a symbol that comes up again and again over the door at Downing Street, this symbolism of the sun coming up over the horizon like that. And until I saw a close-up, I didn't realize it had the rays of the sun in between them as well. In America, NBC, what you see on the screen all the time while you're watching a program is that symbolism again. And you find Illuminati symbolism on all the networks in America. On the side of the Freemasonic Lodge in Boston, a massive depiction of the sun, illumination, Illuminati. The sun gods, ancient sun gods, they used to worship. They used to put a halo around their head to indicate they were actually symbolizing the sun and weren't actually real people. And again, like I said earlier, the lion, the sun symbol within the Illuminati code, you find all over British royalty. Now this is a symbol that they used to use in the ancient world that we see around us in various forms right up to this day. They used to symbolize the movement of the sun through the year with this symbol. They put the zodiac circle, which comes from a Greek word meaning animal circle, appropriately, around the circle, and then they put the cross across the middle to create the four seasons, and then they put the sun on the cross in the middle. I've heard that somewhere before too. And what they used to do was symbolize the movement of the sun in relation to the earth, or the earth in relation to the sun, through the year by symbolizing it as the life of a man. So at this point, they would say, this is the winter solstice, 3 days after that, they used to say the sun was born or born again, because the winter solstice, which has become our December 22nd, 23rd, that kind of time, 21, 22, was the lowest point in the northern hemisphere of the power of the sun. So they said symbolically it had died. 3 days later, which in our calendar became December the 25th, the birthday of Jesus, they said the sun, that one, was born or born again, and they took it around the year. It became a bigger and bigger man. At the peak of the summer solstice, it became a massively strong man with long golden hair, symbolizing the powerful rays of the sun. And then as the man came down into the house of Virgo the Virgin, some say the house of Delilah, he had his hair cut, because the rays of the sun, as you go into the autumn, the fall, are getting shorter and shorter. And then by the time they come round to here, they used to symbolize him like we symbolize old Father Time, an old man at the end of its life. It's all symbolism, and that can be found all over the place. This is in the square where the Ritz Hotel is in Paris, which represents the Sun King in the history of France. This is another version of it, which is the symbol of NATO, the North American, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, which is a wholly owned subsidiary of the Illuminati and has been created to evolve with others into the world army that would impose the will of the world government. This is again the same symbolism of the cross with the sun, and this is the symbol of the CIA. The CIA is part of this Illuminati, if you like, sun cult. And it is a part of the security network in America that has nothing to do with security and everything to do with creating a network of control of the people, which is unfolding more and more every day since 9/11. Again, in the center of the city of London, you've got this same symbol recurring again, right next to St. Paul's Cathedral, in the heart of this very big center for the Illuminati worldwide. Here you have, a lot of people have put symbolism in their paintings, like Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo da Vinci was a grand master, according to this book, Holy Blood, Holy Grail, of a major secret society, a very elite one called the Priory of Sion, S-I-O-N, which was created at the same time that the Knights Templar was created, and its role was to advance the power of the Merovingian bloodline. That was his very reason for existing. And what he's done, Da Vinci here, has put this same symbolism into a painting of the Last Supper. There's the halo, which they used to put over the sun gods in the ancient world, and he's broken up the 12 disciples into four sets of three. Why is it that religious deities seem invariably to have 12 followers? Why do we have King Arthur and the 12 knights of the round table, the zodiac circle? Symbolism. And interestingly, right at the entrance to the temple I was in Boston, Freemasonic headquarters, they have that same picture outside, because these things mean things to them. Even in the street plans of the cities, they put their symbolism in. This is the center of the street plan of Paris, the Arc de Triomphe. They have 12 streets going off there, and the circle in the middle, the sun in the middle, and on the street there in Paris, they've even put the rays of the sun on the road. All around us, this stuff's going on. This is a major symbol of the Illuminati, the skull and bones. The Templars at the time of their purge were accused of using skull and bones in their rituals and stuff. And this is on a Freemasonic apron from the 18th century. And because of the skull and bones symbolism, that's why the most notorious secret society in America, at Yale University in Connecticut, is called the Skull and Bones Society. And these take 15 students, bloodline students, into their ranks every year and initiate them into the web. Part of the ritual, apparently, is lying naked in a coffin, telling your sexual exploits to all the other people. There's people dressed as devils. And on my website, there's a account of a newspaper journalist on the New York Observer who used night vision equipment and other stuff to record one of these, part of these rituals, which goes on in the courtyard at the back. And it's absolutely bizarre. And he was a member of the Skull and Bone Society. His father was, he was, or he is. And the Skull and Bone Society is a network of cementing apparently unconnected people right the way through American politics, banking, business, and media ownership, who are working to the same end while appearing to be unconnected in the daily arena. This is a major symbol of the Illuminati going way back into the ancient world, and it's on the dollar bill. It's called the Pyramid and All-Seeing Eye. And the pyramid with the eye on, is the peak of the pyramid is raised above the rest. That's the power in the pyramid, in the Illuminati hierarchy, manipulating the people. That was put on the dollar bill in 1933 by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, one of the major frontmen for the Illuminati in America in the 20th century. And you find that a lot. Apparently in the words around it translated says something like, he favors our undertaking, new order of the ages. New world order is one of the code phrases they have for this globalization agenda. The Reynolds Tobacco Factory family in America were one of these bloodlines, and they used that in their advertising. See, think you've seen it all. Again, the all-seeing eye. You see it in many adverts of companies as well. And here we have, very recently, since 9/11, the American government have started this organization, the Information Awareness Office, to spin the story to the people, to get the people to believe what they want them to believe, and they use that very same symbol going over the earth for this organization. They're symbolism obsessed. This is British intelligence. MI5, Military Intelligence 5. Again, there's the pyramid peak, there's the eye. That too is part of this network. And when you go high enough in the British intelligence pyramid, you are controlled by the same people that control the CIA pyramid, the same people that control German intelligence pyramid. I talked on the phone when I was researching the 9/11 book to a guy called Andreas von Bülow, who was the defense minister in the German government some years ago. And he told me that when he took that job, he realized the German government knew absolutely nothing about who controlled its intelligence agency. He actually wrote a book called In the Name of the State, explaining this. At the peak of the pyramid, all these intelligence agencies are the same organization. MI6, again, the feel of that building is the pyramid with a capstone missing. You go to Dealey Plaza, and again, where they killed Kennedy, and there is, again in the street plan, the pyramid with the capstone missing, if you look at it from above. Now, if I saw that in isolation, you might say, oh, hold on a second, you know, there are coincidences, don't go over the top, mate. But when you research this year after year, the level of obsession with symbolism is absolutely astonishing. This place was the site of the first Freemasonic temple in Dallas, and is called the Trinity region. This is the Trinity River just here. And everything is done in a place in a ritual fashion. And that's why they killed Kennedy there. I'll get back to that in a second. CBS, Columbia Semiramis Broadcasting, has the eye, the all-seeing eye, on the screen all the time you're watching the program. But there's no greater expression of Illuminati symbolism than the lighted torch or the flame. That is the key one that's gone all the way through history. The illuminated ones. This is a statue put in Rockefeller Center in New York by the Rockefellers of a Greek figure of myth called Prometheus holding the flame. To the Rockefellers, who were one of these Illuminati bloodlines, that would be extremely significant symbolism. And that's why the Queen Semiramis symbolism on the Statue of Liberty is holding the lighted torch. The torch of liberty, according to what the American people are told, in fact, it's the torch of the Illuminati held by Queen Semiramis. We're running the show, we're showing you, and you think you're looking at freedom. Same thing. Also in France, on an island in the River Seine, again, same symbolism, Queen Semiramis is a virtual mirror image of the Statue of Liberty and the goddess of the Republic. Now, when they killed Kennedy in Dealey Plaza, the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry afterwards put up an obelisk, again an Illuminati symbol going way back, the phallic symbol, and on the top they put the lighted torch. We killed him, we're telling you, but you can't see it, can you? From that day to this, they put the lighted torch on the grave of Kennedy. We killed him, we're telling you, you can't see it, can you? Right on top of the Pont d'Alma tunnel, where people take their tributes to Princess Diana, is a massive, exact replica of the flame held by the Statue of Liberty standing on a black pentagram. The same thing comes up again and again. Now, because, as I'll get into when we've had a break, the Nazis were created by the same network that was behind the Allies in the Second World War, and because the Nazis were created by this secret society network I'm talking about, the same symbolism was used by them. This guy's won the sodding lottery. There's the Knights of Malta symbol. There's the skull and bones that has come up again and again. There's the tampered with swastika to indicate the negative. And there's the eagle, which evolved as an Illuminati symbol out of the phoenix bird of Egypt. And this symbolism is not just to talk to the subconscious and not just for show. It means something. How many people in America know this, but as some lawyers have now exposed, this is the case. When I first went to America, I couldn't understand why, when I went into a government building or anything kind of official, The bloody American flag had a gold fringe round it. What did they put a gold fringe around it? That's not the American flag, is it? Then you realize something. There is something called the international law of the flag. And it goes back to the time of when lots of things were happening on ships moving around the world. And the law of the flag is that whatever flag is flying on the ship, that is the law under which that ship is run. And by walking on the ship and seeing that flag, you are accepting that you will be judged under that law. A flag with a gold fringe around it means maritime law, in other words, court-martial law in effect, and also comes under something called the Uniform Commercial Code. And a number of lawyers in America have now started to get wise to this, because the reason they put a gold fringe around the American flag in every court of America, in every federal building and every federal agency, is because while walking into that building with that flag flying, including a court, you are accepting that you will be judged, tried in court under maritime law and the Universal Commercial Code, which completely pushes aside the Constitution of the United States and all the laws passed through Congress. And people don't know that. Just to give you an idea of how the street thing works, it works massively and most obviously in Washington, D.C., where they had a blank sheet of paper to go with. First of all, this is the entrance to the Mother Lodge of Freemasonry in London. I show that because the reversed pentagram, like I said earlier, is a classic symbol of Satanism, reverse symbolism from the five-pointed star. And this comes from a book called Talisman of the United States, in which this American guy painstakingly went through the street plan of Washington and found it was absolutely awash with esoteric symbols and reverse symbols like this. When they are reversing their symbolism, they either reverse it literally or they distort it, these esoteric symbols, so they're no longer balanced, and that indicates the negative also. And in the street plan, this is the White House, this is the Congress building. In the White House one, you've got the reverse pentagram in the street plan. You've got that there as well with the Congress building. And if you go, of course, into the center of a pentagram, you have a pentagon. And it's an absolutely no accident why the center headquarters of the American military is in a building shaped and called by that name. But if you go through the center from the White House, very short distance, through the middle here, you get somewhere here, you find a very strange building in Washington, this one. It's got a feel of ancient Egypt. You've got the symbolic representation here of the Sphinx. And behind there, you've got our old friend, the sun coming up over the horizon, the symbol of Horus from Egypt, closer view of it. So what is this building in Washington, for goodness sake, in 2003? It's the Supreme Headquarters, 33rd degree, Scottish Rite of Freemasonry. Because Freemasonry did not begin, like I said earlier, in the 1700s. It goes way back into the ancient world and can be followed through under different names right the way through to the present day. And that's why they have this symbolism. And the chair of Washington, he has a statue in the back of that organizer, of that building, that Supreme Headquarters. And this is a picture in that Freemasonic headquarters in Boston. They certainly aren't talking about Freemasonry starting in the 1700s, and they're depicting it coming all the way through history as, in effect, a hidden hand behind people in power and global events from centuries past through centuries to come. And again, you look at the Rosicrucians, another organization which at its peak locks into the network. Lots of people involved lower down haven't got a clue what they're involved in. And again, that's obsessed with Egyptian symbolism. This, people think, is a political building. It's actually a temple to this secret society, the Illuminati that control it. I've seen that somewhere before, I'm sure. St. Paul's Cathedral, which is at the center of the Illuminati operational headquarters in many ways, though there are other places, the City of London. The reason they call this Capitol Hill is not, again, oh, we'll call it Capitol Hill, that's a good name. They name it after Capitoline Hill, which was one of the places of worship at the time that the Illuminati were controlling the Roman Empire. And when one of the high priestesses of American politics, Madeleine Albright, was made Secretary of State by Clinton, her first overseas visit was to Europe and to Capitoline Hill in Italy, which would have been very significant to the people in the Illuminati who know what it means. Okay, last little section and we'll have a break here. Many things in this journey through the last 13 years have blown my mind, and is more to come. But grasping the fact that people were involved in human sacrifice ceremonies and stuff back in the ancient world, okay, get my head around that. The fact even that some really kind of imbalanced people could be doing it today, yep, get my head around that. What I really hit me was the scale at which this goes on, and some of the most famous people on this planet are involved in it. And Satanism, just a word for human sacrifice and other deeply dark rituals, child abuse, like the stuff that comes to light in children's homes, which is the tip of a massive iceberg, and mind control, where they create mind-controlled zombies to carry out things like assassinations to hide the fact that it's really behind them, are all fundamentally connected. These guys are into some very dark, dark stuff. And when you realize, I'll say this, what they're into, it is no longer a problem understanding how these guys can send the troops in to slaughter thousands of people and have no emotional empathy with the suffering whatsoever, so much so, okay, that's done, now who next? Because what they're doing all the time, they do not have ability to empathize with the people who they are their victims. Now this is a place, a notorious place in America for those that have investigated this elite connection to satanic rituals and what have you, called Bohemian Grove. It's 75 miles north of San Francisco, and it's in 2,700 acres of redwood forest. Go down there, eventually you get to it. And every year in July, the elite of America, we're talking the Kissingers and the Rockefellers and the Bushes, and all these people that control the media and the banking and the transnational corporations, they arrive at Bohemian Grove for a summer camp to let the cares of the world drop from their shoulders. Talking to people as I have, and some people have written books about their experiences, but of course they don't get out there in the mainstream at all. What goes on at Bohemian Grove among this elite is utterly, utterly staggering, but not staggering to me any longer. Here is a picture taken at Bohemian Grove in 1957. This is a guy called Glenn Seaborg, who gave the world plutonium. Nice man, bro, very helpful. Now, Bohemian Grove, 1957. Ooh, Tricky Dicky. Uncle Ron. One's a B-movie actor at the time, getting on and on his horse. And the other one is 3 years from taking on Kennedy in the 1960 election. Both members of Bohemian Grove, this elite club, both go on, despite their very different backgrounds, to become president of the United States. Why? Because presidents aren't elected, they are selected. Now, this was a picture taken on a long lens by a journalist who got into Bohemian Grove some years ago. It's much clearer on the original. Going through the computer, it, you know, kind of clouds it a bit, to say the least. But this is a 40-foot stone frickin' owl. And over here are all the Bohemian Grovers, observing this opening ritual. Now, the real deal, as the people I've talked to over the years have told me, goes on in smaller groups of elite in the forest during the rest of the week. But this is the opening ritual. It's called the cremation of care, where they say they're burning their cares away and all that stuff. And over here are all these people in bloody robes carrying out this Babylonian-type ceremony. Now, the 40-foot stone owl. These are the people who are running our freaking world. These are the people coming on CNN and what have you, and BBC and ITN, telling us what should happen and what's going to happen. About 2 years ago, there's a talk show host in America called Alex Jones. And what he did, yay! And he got in there with a camera in a bag during this opening ritual. And, you know, because it's in a bag, you know, the whole film itself is moving around a bit, although it's very good. But the sound is absolutely impeccable. And this is just one clip from it. And what you see, and if you go into a website called Infowars.com, you get a copy of the whole tape. And what you see on it is, first of all, you have all these people in the robes over here. Here's the bloody owl here. And over here, all these people. Bush came to this week at Bohemian Grove, President Bush. And what you see eventually, look at these bloody things over here. You see a body floated in here. They say it's an effigy. I'm open to the fact that it was, because what I'm told, like I say, is that the real deal goes on in the smaller groups in the forest during the week. But it could have been real, it could not have been real, whatever. Still bizarre. And what they do then is they take the body off and they put it on a slab here under the owl, and they set a fire. Now, what you hear very clearly on this tape, whatever the background, is when they set fire to this effigy body, you hear a blood-curdling, bloody scream. Now, one of two things are happening here. Either they're actually doing it to somebody, or they've actually put a blood-curdling scream on the tape to blast out as part of the ritual. Either way, these are the people running our world and deciding to bomb Iraq or Kabul or anywhere they freaking choose. And 6 billion people are watching it. We don't have to. And if we didn't, they couldn't. So the symbol of the Bohemian Club, as they call it, is the owl. Now, the owl is significant to the Illuminati going right back to Babylon. This is an original Babylonian depiction of a Babylonian goddess, and they are guarded by the owl. How interesting that I should find this on a map of the Congress building in Washington. All I've done is drawn a red line around the roads within the complex of the Congress building, and it's got the Congress in its belly. How appropriate. Now, this next one, I have done absolutely nothing to. It is just a straight shot from a street directory you can find anywhere in Washington today. An owl with the Congress in its belly standing on a pyramid. Everything is symbolism to these people. Washington is absolutely awash with it. Now, just after Washington died, I think it was, some time after Washington died, they decided they wanted a statue of him. So I'm sure there was someone in America that could build a statue, but they got it from northern Italy. And when it arrived and they unveiled it, this is in the Smithsonian Museum now in Washington, when they unveiled it, it was like, what have you done to our George? Naked from the waist down, Bill Clinton's covered with a piece of cloth, arm in the air, thing down here, what's going on? Aghast the people were. Well, maybe, just maybe, that is what's going on. This is the combination. This is a combination symbol of the negative force, devil, whatever these people are into, called Baphomet, which the Templars were also said to have been worshipping all this time ago. He'll come back soon as well. Now, the symbol in Satanism for the devil, the negative force, is holding the two middle fingers down and the two outside fingers up, or just keeping them down without using the thumb. I didn't realize that till I started looking at this, but that's what it is. There we go, another version of it. How funny, the number of times you see these people. The number of times you see these people, these are just a few examples of the way they use this symbol. I mean, that might be a kind of just a one-off, but is that a one-off? Is that a one-off? Is that a one-off or that a one-off? And then you've got in Italy, this guy Berlusconi, Illuminati placeman extraordinaire. It's like having Rupert Murdoch as Prime Minister of Britain. He's there, major Illuminati player. Is that an accident or coincidence? Say. They're laughing at us, but not for much freaking longer. Now. I'm going to draw to a close here, and then I'm really going to concentrate on what's happening today and how we're being affected today, because it's very important. But these stories that come to light about the mass abuse of children in children's homes and what have you, I can tell you, it's one of the things I've really kind of researched and come across in both America and Britain and elsewhere in the last 13 years. It is absolutely all over the place, this abuse of children. And it comes to light very, very rarely. These were the kids in North Wales who were abused for years and years, and no one did anything about it. And the reason it happens, and I'll connect this in a second to Satanism and mind control, the reason it happens is because of this same structure. You have this few at the top who are controlling all the different elements necessary to cover up what they are doing. You do not have to control everyone in social services to stop an investigation into a very famous person abusing children. You only have to control those levels of social services that decide if an investigation is going to go ahead. You don't have to control every policeman to stop a police investigation into the same thing. You only have to control those levels of the police that decide if the investigation is going to go ahead or not. You also control the media, which shuts a lot of this stuff up or ridicules it, and all these other areas that stop the real deal coming out. So whatever comes out is a tiny, tiny fraction of the children being abused every day by some of the most famous people on earth. Aren't they, Father George Bush? Yes, they are, constantly. This is how it works. And they want this to happen. For this reason, there are an enormous number, millions in America, of mind-controlled people. The government mind control project, MK Ultra, actually some of it came to light back in the 70s to such an extent that the government had to settle out of court with some people to stop the thing going to court and the whole thing starting to come out. But what came out was once again a fraction of what actually happens. And there are offshoots of MK Ultra that are specific for certain tasks like assassinations and what have you, that are perpetrated by the very people I'm talking about here to advance their agenda. And it works like this. We have a mechanism in the mind which shuts out the memory of extreme trauma. This is what kicks in when we have a really bad road smash and we can't remember the immediate run-up to the impact on what happened afterwards. And on that level, it's a good thing, because what the mind does is it puts an amnesic barrier around the memory of extreme trauma. Therefore, good thing, we don't keep reliving the horror in our conscious mind. What they realized, and one of the key people involved in this in the modern world, because they've known about this for a long time, was Joseph Mengele, the angel of death in the concentration camps of Germany, who had an endless number of people on which to experiment, particularly children. And they perfected a form of mind control called trauma-based mind control, in which, to be most effective, you start with children before the age of 5 and 6. And what you do is you traumatize them in every way you can think of. You first of all establish what makes them most terrified, and then you make them experience it. You make them experience having animals sacrificed in front of them, children sacrificed in front of them. You have them abused sexually and violently, and what happens is, because the mind shuts out extreme trauma, amnesic barriers form like a honeycomb all around the mind. In the mind control industry, they call them alters. They give people a front alter, which is the personality that people around them think is them, the one that interacts with people in the daily world. What they do, however, and what they found, is that you can program these alters, these amnesic barriers, each of which are under the impression they are the whole mind, with certain programs and with certain tasks. And you push these programmed alters into the subconscious, and the front alter, which they give you, oh yes, that's old Billy, or that's old Mary, yes sir, I know her. But in the back are these programs, and all they need is whatever has been programmed in as the trigger word, the trigger phrase, the trigger color, the trigger sound. And when that trigger happens, the front alter swaps with the back alter, and that becomes in control of events. We've all heard about the Manchurian candidates and all that stuff. We're talking that massively advanced. And what they do with these people, and I've talked to so many of them who've begun to have these flashback memories and start to get their mind back, talk to endless numbers of them around the world, and they all tell the same basic story, and they all tell of the same basic people over and over again who were involved with it. And what they do is they will program a alter with an assassination program to a target victim, and then when the programming is triggered, they will carry out that programming. They will go into a school in Dunblane and blow children away. They will blow someone away that the Illuminati want out of the way. And what they do with assassination programs a lot of the time is they program the front altar to be, as we say, not quite the full picnic. So that when the assassination program is activated and they blow someone away, people who knew them go, yeah, well, he was a bit strange. There was something about, yeah, he was a strange man. Oh, he's just a nutter then. End of flipping story. No road back to who's really behind it. And the other thing they do is that they activate back altars to become the front altar when children are abused mercilessly by people like Father George Bush and others. And then when the abuse is over, the altar that experienced it is pushed back in the mind, the front altar comes back, that child does not know what has happened to it, cannot remember. And it's only much later in life, and it's happened to more and more people, that the memory suddenly floods back as the amnesic barrier breaks down. And there are millions of there's an organization in America called the Delta Force. Within the mind control community, they're known as the toy soldiers because their very training is designed to turn them into, yes, sir, who shall I shoot, sir? Boo, thank you, sir, zombies. I'll just finish here on this bit, we'll have a break, but one of the greatest forms of programming is subliminal. I'll get this towards the end, which talks to the subconscious mind. And one of the greatest programmers of children, the common of common themes of children programmed in these elite mind control projects in America is Disneyland and Disney and the Disney Corporation. And how interesting that in that Freemasonic headquarters in Boston, I should find this from the International Du Molay, Walt Disney, which has now been taken over by a bigger corporation. And guess how many of them there are around there? 12, of course there were. Would there be any other? The Disney Corporation is a major Illuminati operation targeting children. And as J. Edgar Hoover said, the infamous head of the FBI, and he should know, the individual is handicapped by coming face to face with a conspiracy so monstrous he cannot believe it exists, and that is its greatest form of defense. what's going on in the world compared with the movie we're told with going on, the chasm between them is so absolutely vast that even when it comes to light, you go, people go, you're bloody mad, you are. Truth is, though, more and more people are making that jump. And this is just one reality which we've allowed to unfold. It does not have to happen. They're using our power to do it. We take it back. It's over. House of cards, thank you, gone. It's just a choice. And we can build a reality represented by this by changing our own attitudes and the way we imprison each other and the way we let these guys get away with it without question. Or we can sit there watching Coronation Street and Wheel of Bloody Fortune and allow this to reach its intended goal, a global fascist state. Okay, I've gone on. You know, it's just kind of funny. I've had the bloody hands-on healing. I've had the crystal therapy. I've had the acupuncture, and I've still got verbal sodding diarrhea. I can't shift it. But if we could take a quick break, because I've got so much to say and so much to pass on. Say if we could start back at 4:05, and I want to really go into 9/11, Iraq, and all this stuff, and the real deal of what's gone on. Thank you very much.